So my name's Peter O'Brien, and on behalf of UC CIRI, which is the Collaborative Indigenous Research Initiative at the University of Canberra, it's really a delight to welcome all of you here today for today's seminar. I want to begin by acknowledging the Ngunnawal people, traditional owners of the land on which we meet, and pay my respects to Ngunnawal elders past and present. I also want to acknowledge Professor Nick Plomp, our Deputy Vice-Chancellor for Education. We appreciate your interest and support, Nick. We're delighted too that so many of you are here with an interest in the subject of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander higher education. From the University of Canberra, Prime Minister and Cabinet, Department of Education and Training, Institute of Health and Welfare, CSU and PricewaterhouseCoopers, among others. So it's a pretty rich brew of people with an interest in the subject. There were two very significant events last week. First, the 12th of February was the 50th anniversary of the Freedom Ride. Remembering that half a century ago, 29 brave students from the University of Sydney boarded a bus and travelled through rural Australia to see and raise awareness of racism and Indigenous disadvantage. To hotels, cafes and public pools. They were heckled and pushed, pelted with eggs and tomatoes. Outside Walgett, they were run off the road by a truck. And they pressed on, raising awareness of unacceptable conditions of racism and demand. Come forward on the 11th of February last week, Prime Minister Abbott, who was having a big week, tabled the 7th Closing the Gap report, which he described as profoundly disappointing. The report shows failure to close the gap on measures of life expectancy, early childhood education, reading, writing, numeracy, and employment. So while the Freedom Riders might be delighted to see that the issues that so distressed them 50 years ago are clearly on the national agenda, they would also surely be dismayed by the lack of progress. So I think we can agree there is much to do, and that might be in part why you're here. I mentioned UC CIRI. Late in 2013, a group of researchers at the university got together to form this new collaborative research initiative. The purpose of the group is to encourage coordination and collaboration on Indigenous research at the university and wider with our wider networks. We want to grow our collaboration, to grow the amount of Indigenous research at this university, to grow impact, profile and resources. So that's our focus. One of the things we're doing is this seminar series, and these seminars will feature Indigenous research being undertaken here and elsewhere, and eminent speakers from across Australia. So that brings me to today's seminar. We're delighted to have Peter Radoll return to the University of Canberra to present in our seminar series. With the push towards whole of university approaches to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander education, universities have developed many different models with different levels of success, and Peter's going to draw on his experience, which is wide across the sector, to discuss some of the critical success factors. Let me tell you a bit about our speaker, who will be known, I think, to most of you. Peter's an Aboriginal man from the Anawan Nation in northern New South Wales. He's inaugural Dean of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Education and Research and Director of the Wollotuka Institute at the University of Newcastle. Before he took up this position, he held various roles in the university sector, including Director of the Jabal Indigenous Higher Education Centre and Lecturer in Information Systems at ANU, Acting Director of the Ngunnawal Centre at the University of Canberra, and Assistant Professor in Information Systems at the University of Canberra. He holds a Bachelor and Master degrees in Information Technology from UC, and his PhD, Stone Chips to Silicon Chips, from the Australian National University, examine the adoption and effective use of information technology in Australia's remote, rural and urban Aboriginal communities. Please join me in welcoming Peter.
Thank you very much. I just want to acknowledge the traditional owners as well, and acknowledge Ngunnawal men here, and Adrian as well, who's come to see us today. I want to thank all you guys for coming and visiting. I haven't had a crowd like this for a presentation or a seminar for a very long time. So it's very encouraging, I can tell you, I can assure you. Today, as we heard from Peter just then, last week we saw the latest Closing the Gap report being released. And it's really a sad reality that, for the most part, the Indigenous employment and education targets won't be met, okay? It's a very, very sad day to hear that. So what can we do to actually ensure that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people reach parity? What can we do to make sure that we close the gap in our little bit of space? And I'm going to talk to you about that today, about what we can do in universities and how do we do this properly. One positive outcome from the Closing the Gap report was we're on target to halve Year 12 attainment by 2020. It's not closed, by the way. It's only half the attainment. I think it's really interesting to note that less than 50% of schools in Australia, less than 50%, have an Indigenous attendance rate of 90% or better. And what does it say about schools? But one of the things that really heartens me about this, attainment or the more of our mob completing year 11 and 12, is that there's a great opportunity here for universities to play a significant role in closing the gap. For us, we need to close the gap in our space. Because I know, looking at the data, that Indigenous completions at university aren't that great either. Okay. Indigenous enrolments aren't that fabulous either, but they're increasing. So what are the critical success factors in Indigenous higher education or Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander higher education? So today I want to speak very personally, from my perspective, things that I've seen over the time, and I could talk from the ASPA committee, those of you would know about the ASPA committees many years ago, right through to where I am today. And I've worked in a number of institutions, I've been on boards of different departments and different institutions. But I want to talk specifically about what I've seen and what I believe are core values or core critical success factors that I've seen that work, okay, that I've seen that work. Of course, we could talk about ABS data and we could talk about, you know, Professor Martin Nakata's work around how do we engage Indigenous students, but this is just a reflection of my time that I've spent in Indigenous higher education. So I think, firstly, we need to look at what assistance we provide Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students. Now, assistance comes in three forms, as I see it: academic, resources, and financial. These are the three key components, I think, that we need to focus on. Academic assistance is primarily provided through study skills offices and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander centres. Then there are foundation programs that ensure there's a gap filled between high school and to university. These are key components of a strategy to ensure that we have success. There's also the Indigenous Tutorial Assistance Scheme, which is about to be defunct and replaced with the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, but I'll touch on that a little bit later on. These things are what I call critical success factors. Today, as you've heard, I've managed to become Dean and Professor at the University of Newcastle and also wear another hat as Director of Wollotuka as well. A significant position for anybody. But would it surprise you to know, those in the room, that I actually started my higher education career, if you like, or journey, doing the Ngunnawal Centre's foundation program here in the mid-90s. Does anyone know that? Most people do. So it worries me then, if we don't have ITAS, or we don't have Indigenous centres, and we don't have Indigenous people driving the foundation programs, then how are we going to have success? I just want to think of that for a second. Because there's no way on this earth that I would be standing here today if I didn't have an Aboriginal mentor, a cultural mentor, through my journey. I would not be here today if I didn't have the assistance under ITAS that provided very, very generously from the federal government, by the way, not the university, but very, very generously from the federal government, to actually provide assistance to fill the gaps that my Year 10 education provided me. want you to really understand that Indigenous centres on campus are imperative to Indigenous success. They are the most important component of any Indigenous success strategy, okay? They are so very important. Not only does it provide a visible presence to the university and it provides some sort of interface, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on, but it also provides significant place for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students to gather for academic, community and cultural purposes. They are critical to any university's Indigenous success strategy. Indigenous centres are responsible for almost everything, it seems. I've been director of a few centres now, and everything with a capital I sort of lands on your desk, even though there's a nominal sort of whole of university approach. But ordinary, you know, most Indigenous centres have a very narrow focus about student support, very narrow focus. And if you're really lucky, you get some teaching, and if you're extremely lucky, you also get some research leadership out of the Indigenous Centre as well. And in fact, even the Ngunnawal Centre provides that support and direction in a pure support centre, and I did that at ANU as well. But don't forget, even the student support centres, the Indigenous centres that are student support only, without teaching and research, are best placed to run Indigenous foundation programs. And I strongly believe that. This whole idea of mainstreaming Indigenous foundation programs for whatever particular reason, whether it's for structural adjustment or whether it's for budgetary constraints, you'll have mixed success with those Indigenous foundation programs that are not driven by the Indigenous centres. And I've seen this time and time again across the sector. Universities do some strange things. They assume that Aboriginal people are the same as everybody else. It's really interesting. But as we know, not all Aboriginal students go to the university's Indigenous centre for whatever reason. And if you listen to some of the commentary leading up to the freedom rides, the journey, or the new journey, I suppose, that took off from Sydney today, the buses, you know, Rachel Perkins was saying there's an emerging middle class, Indigenous middle class now, who probably don't need Indigenous centres necessarily. So how do we ensure we support them? Well, I believe that faculties should be responsible for knowing each and every Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander student they have. They should. Most universities have such low numbers of Indigenous students that Indigenous centres should know their students personally, even by name. And those in the room from ANU and from UC, the students, will know that I took the time to do that. Okay. I took the time to know everybody personally, and their parents, and their sisters, and their brothers. It's really important to do that. Universities like the University of Newcastle, or Charles Sturt University, for example, who carried around 1,000 Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students, may be forgiven for not knowing everyone personally. And it's true, I only know about 30 or 40 students at the moment. It's going to be hard to know 1,000 students. But the faculties are the ones. The faculties are where Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students either fail or succeed. They're the barometer. That's where the students have to go. They don't have to come to the Indigenous Centre if they don't want to. But they have to go. They have to go to the faculties. Now, this is where I think there's an opportunity for a more closer personal engagement that can take place between the faculty, the university if you like, and the Indigenous student. And by doing this, you get an incredible opportunity to actually do amazing things. Well, I did this at ANU. Everyone was sort of, you know, we don't really want to mainstream our support necessarily, but the students weren't coming to the centre. It's only probably about 40 or 50% of the students will come to the centre. So what I did, I actually managed to mainstream, I suppose, or put some things in place to make sure that the faculties would actually ensure that these students were actually engaged. And as a result of doing that, we had enormous completions. So much so, our completion rate increased, that we couldn't keep up the number of students to come into the ANU because the ANU had a significant ATAR to get into the university. So when you're looking at statistics, you know, things can go backwards in terms of physical numbers, but completions went up significantly. I think also it's really important that this faculty-based support, if you like, or engagement, which is what we prefer to use. It's not support, it's engagement. It's not the only part of the engagement, and it's not a reason to get rid of your Indigenous Centre. It's not a reason to do that. It's not a reason to get rid of your Indigenous Centre, because it plays a very important role. The faculty is supplementary to your Indigenous Student Centre. As for financial support, the government provides financial assistance in terms of AB study, Indigenous support program, and targeted funding. Now, those who are not familiar with Indigenous higher education, the universities get what we call our ISP, and it's a supplementary funding scheme that the federal government provides to the universities. But increasingly, this is tenuous. As we've seen, the move away from secured ongoing funding around ITAS to the more competitive grant round now of the Indigenous Advancement Strategy. And this is probably something we're going to see more and more as the fiscal sort of situation becomes a little bit more tight. Remember, ISP is actually supplementary funding. It's not primary funding. So the whole idea of ISP is to supplement what the university is already doing. Not use it as primary funding, but many universities do use it as primary funding and rely very, very heavily on it rather than the supplementary component that it's meant to be. With the constant changing of political cycles, where particular programs pop up and others are taken away, it's very difficult to rely on this funding forever. And I think it's going to be very difficult for universities to actually rely on Indigenous support funding, which is always 2 years behind your EFSL aid, by the way. It's always 2 years behind. So you might have a huge enrollment. Let's say the university got an extra 100 students tomorrow. You won't see that funding for 2 years. So how are you going to manage those 100 students in that meantime? And it's a major problem. Unless you can convince the hierarchy that, you know, you do need the extra funding. My concern, I suppose, is that with the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, not all students are going to have the same contact nor the same opportunity as those under the ITAS program. It's just simply not going to be. The federal government made it very clear when they moved to the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, there's going to be less money on offer. It's going to be less money on offer. So without this, my feeling is without this funding, without ITAS, we're going to see what happened in 1996 and 2001 when AB study changes occurred. Does anyone know what happened? There was a significant drop-off in participation of Aboriginal and Torres Islander people. I don't think the participation will drop off, but I can tell you now I'm certain that completions will. Without that support, completions will. They will drop off. Therefore, I would urge that every university must invest in Indigenous higher education if we're going to maintain our current level of success. We're going to have to do this. Under the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, we've got no choice. If you want your current level of success today, universities are going to have to invest to make up that gap that we don't get from the Indigenous Advancement Strategy. And you think, with the attainment increasing and completions of Year 12 increasing and more students are coming to university, we're going to have more money to support that. And the universities are going to come up with a strategy to deal with this. Another critical success factor, from my perspective at least, is a good Indigenous higher education strategy. And I'm not talking about a reconciliation action plan. That's not a strategy. They're aspirational, okay? It's not a strategy. RAP, it's not a strategy. They're aspirational. And by strategy, I mean a full-on considered strategy, something that's gone through all the proper committees in the university and is driven from the top. It's driven from the top. So the Vice-Chancellor down has responsibility for KPIs, and everybody has this opportunity then to have input into the strategy, but also have responsibility for the strategy. Now, RAPs are great things, and anyone at the University of Canberra and Australian National University know that I'm a huge fan of Reconciliation Action Plans, because without them, not many institutions really give any consideration to Indigenous employment, and that's the truth. Well, that's my experience of the truth. Okay, so RAPs sort of boost, I suppose, or prod universities into saying, oh yeah, we've got to have some employment, we've got some employment targets here, we really need to do that. I know the NTU does a lot of work in this space as well, but the RAPs are the locally owned products. Now, RAPs are really, really interesting because there's three parts of Reconciliation Action Plan, right? Isn't there? Reconciliation, Action, and Plan. Sure, that's easy. But what's really interesting is most institutions I'm not just picking on universities, most institutions forget the bit in the middle, the important bit, the action. They forget that bit. And if you're going to have a whole of university approach and you've got a reconciliation action plan, why not give everybody an action to do within that plan? That's a whole of university approach. Give everyone a KPI to meet in the Indigenous space. What's wrong with that? I believe a good Indigenous higher education strategy should also include student recruitment strategy, an Indigenous student retention strategy, an Indigenous community engagement strategy, an Indigenous cultural affirmation program, an Indigenous staff strategy that incorporates something that almost every university gets, workforce planning. Indigenous student recruitment strategy should really focus on engaging new students, trying to get more students into the university, and we should do that. And I know this institution, I know most institutions really work really hard in this space, and I know there's a huge team over here that does amazing work in the Indigenous space to try and bring more students to the university, and that's very admirable. And we struggle to find measures. How are we successful? And any measures we can is look at the numbers of students coming to university. But also, that Indigenous recruitment strategy is, you know, we should have look at how do we actually ensure we have a transition from undergraduate to postgraduate. Again, something not a lot of universities do for Indigenous students. An Indigenous retention strategy, on top of that, would actively track students' progress. And that's something that I really can't emphasise enough. A lot of universities do this already for their international students, for visa or other obligations. It is so simple to implement the same thing for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students. It really, really is. And I've seen it work really, really well at the institution over the road. Now, I think it's really important, I don't know if anyone's done it at this institution yet, I'm just currently doing it at mine, is have a really long look at the Indigenous data. Have a look at the Indigenous data and say, where are the key issues associated with retention? Now, when I was at the other institution over at ANU, I found there were three really critical times that that were problems for Indigenous students. Week 2, week 6, and the end of first semester. Now, if you could actually get all those and make sure you're engaged with the students along that, they're likely to stay for the whole time. So once they get, you know, usually once the 6 months is up, you're not going to lose them if they haven't got any significant issues. So, what we did at the other institution was to actually run, in the first 2 weeks, constant orientation programs and lunches. Lunches are the best thing. And, because you've got small numbers of students, you know who the new ones are, you really do know the new ones are, with small numbers of students. Then if they didn't turn up, we'd take note who they were. And then we'd actually contact them via email or a phone call, right? To make sure that there's nothing wrong. Can we help you, whatever it is. At the 6 week mark, we did exactly the same thing. We actually physically emailed or rang every single student in the university, not just the new ones, all of them, to make sure that they're back and all that sort of stuff. All of them, all 150 or 200 of them, close to 200 of them. At the 6 month mark, well, it was a bit of a struggle for us, because what we did was to ensure that the faculties took responsibility for the students' progress. So we asked the faculties, and it came down to the course conveners and the program conveners, we asked them to actually send us the first, if any student, any Aboriginal student has any issues, we're failing or close to failing, let us know, because there's things that we can do that you guys can't. And again, if you look at the report that Professor Aileen Morton Robinson did for the Federal Department of Education some years back now, ANU, as putting those things in place, ensured ANU had the number one position for many years for Indigenous student retention. It was a pride of the institution, of the academy, and purely for some very simple things, because we just take care of, it's a personal touch for Aboriginal students. And I think it's well worth the effort, even though there's a bit of kerfuffle to start with that idea, everyone was sort of strange, we wanted to do this for Indigenous students, but it made a big difference, a huge difference. Indigenous community engagement strategy provides localised cultural engagement. And that's so important to your university, for any university. You have to engage with the local Indigenous community if you're going to be successful. Because they're the ones that are going to tell the good stories to their aunties and uncles and their cousins and their brothers. Nothing like word of mouth in our community. The grapevine is amazing, right? because they all know what's going on. If there's issues, they know what's going on. If there's good things, they know what's going on. They know. They do. And it's not just the community. Even the academy tells you what's going on. So. But they know. We know where the good bits are, and we know where the challenges are, okay? So you're really important to engage with the community. Now, this might be a trip, if you like, as we did sometimes at the other place, and we did it here. I mean, I remember doing it here as an undergraduate student in the foundation program, where we went on a trip with elders and looked at significant cultural sites locally. It was an amazing trip. It was awesome to do. Provides cultural engagement. Elders, you can talk to elders about identity, Indigenous identity. Some of the students who come in might have some issues with their identities, and it's just sitting down and having that yarn in terms of the community engagement is really, really important. I can't emphasise that enough. A good Indigenous community engagement strategy engages the local community in activities here at the university, thereby breaking down what I call the barriers between Indigenous education or education institutions and the Indigenous community. We have to actually do this. The strategy should include sort of casual activities, such as the Indigenous community being invited to barbecues or events, maybe even open week, open day, O-week. Mind you, Arnie would sort of raise her eyebrows at O-week, I think, in many ways. So. I know I do. But the university is really important that the university invites the Aboriginal community onto campus, not the Indigenous Centre, not the Indigenous Centre. The university has to invite the community on. The Indigenous Centre, that's a given. Now, for instance, while I was in Canberra at both institutions, I ensured, one of the things I did was ensured, even though I drove it, it's okay, I don't mind doing that we had a store at the most significant times in the Indigenous calendar here in Canberra. And that's NAIDOC, during NAIDOC. NAIDOC on the peninsula. There's about 16,000 people or so go to NAIDOC on the peninsula each year. And I made sure that both institutions that I worked at had a store there, because that's where you engage, right? That's it. That's the point. And in fact, and I don't know if is Francis here today? She's not here. In fact, those who are students, I convinced, and thank you very much to all the deans and I think Nick as well, and the Vice Chancellor for sponsoring the NAIDOC ball a couple of years ago here. University of Canberra sponsored the NAIDOC ball. We had a great time. And how awesome was it? Frances and her husband, Frances, our Deputy Vice Chancellor for Research, Frances Shannon, her husband, Tom Calmer, and others, and other Indigenous and non-Indigenous staff from around the university, we all sat around those two tables and we had the best time. And the good thing about it, there were two big banners, and they said University of Canberra on each side of that stage. And that is awesome. Getting that brand out there makes a big, big difference, and you'd be very surprised how the impact that has. The other important thing, I think, and I think some institutions miss this point, you know, elders play a very, very important role to us as Aboriginal people in our everyday lives. We always go to elders, well, not all of us. Most of us go to elders and consult. I have an issue. What do you think I should do here? Okay? That support still needs to be in universities. So what I'm saying here is that elder and residence program cannot be overstated. You know, I can't talk this up enough. An elder and residence program, someone for the students to go to talk to about a conundrum that they have, because you know what? Being Aboriginal in Torres Strait Islander can be a little bit complicated in a very wide institution. And I've seen it so many times. I've spoken to students about all sorts of matters that didn't relate to me at all, actually. All sorts of matters. And it's just someone to talk to. Now, if I had an elder and residence to be able to do that, so you need to go see Arnie or Uncle, that'd be awesome. It's really, really important. That elder is really, really important. An Indigenous cultural affirmation program is critical, I think, yet seemingly sort of lacking in universities. I know universities take their students on cultural tours overseas, fact-finding missions out bush, or to another university to see how things are done. Yet they don't take Indigenous students on cultural affirmation tours, and I don't know why. I really don't understand why they don't do that. Because by doing that, you're ensuring that you've got a more connected student, not only to the university, but to the local community. And that's better for everybody. You have much more success if they're connected to culture and connected to the institution. Bringing those two together is an awesome outcome. And I think if you don't have that, it's very short-sighted, because out of that interface, if you like, comes a whole stack of research opportunities, indigenisation of curriculum, and recruitment, to be quite honest. The opportunities there, with a little bit of investment, you'd be very surprised. You'd be very, very, very surprised. An Indigenous staff employment strategy is already part of universities. NTU's done a lot of work. Reconciliation plans have done a lot of work. But you know what? Indigenous workforce planning isn't something that I see much across the universities, okay? Workforce planning. Aboriginal people are just like everybody else. We just don't want a job, we want a career. We want opportunities. How do we actually do, how do you actually deal with career force, or workforce planning around Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander staff? It's a major problem for universities, because they're just happy to get an Aboriginal person in the job that they need the person into. And that's where they stay for a long time. They stay there forever. Why is that? Because universities don't do workforce planning. It's really critical that they do workforce planning. And this brings me to the next point, is another crucial or critical success factor in Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander education is the staffing strategy. It is common knowledge, at least I know it's common knowledge, that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students will do better in a university if there isn't, or tend to, if there's Indigenous staff in the university. In fact, if you look at the DWAR data, or the Department of Education now, I'm sorry, and ABS data, the more Indigenous staff in a university, the more Indigenous students are there. Very interesting. There's a very, very strong correlation between the number of Indigenous staff and Indigenous students. And that's no accident. That's no accident. Students make conscious decisions because of the stories that's coming home and they're coming home with. Auntie works here, or uncle works there, or brother works there. And they talk this, they tell this story. And then those students go, well, I'm going to choose that one because I know uncle's going to be there for me. I know he's going to be, or auntie's going to be there for me, or my brother. Role models can't be, again, can't be overemphasised. When I was a student here, all I wanted to do was be like Terry Williams. Anyone remember Terry Williams as a director? It's all I wanted to do. He was the most inspiring person at that particular point in time in my life. And Kay's looking very, looking at me. At the time, you know, he was the director of the Ngunnawal Centre. He talked very aspirationally. He was doing his masters, and that's all I wanted to do. So I did my master's and did my PhD and became a director myself. But the most important thing is role modelling is very, very important. And it's not something that I suppose that can be overemphasised, particularly in the Aboriginal space. Now, that brings me to the next point about who do you want in your Indigenous centre? Who do you want to head up your Indigenous centre? It's always a controversial topic, but I'll touch on it. But it's really important to understand that the person who heads up your Indigenous centre is a leader. I mean, that makes, without saying, right? And it's got to be Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander. But that person that you've chosen, the institution's chosen to be the leader, the Indigenous leader, has to drive the agenda. They can use all the resources of the institution, but they're responsible for the agenda. Not anybody else. Because everybody, it's a bit like, I won't use any analogy, but whenever I travel to institutions, and in the departments and every other board that I've been on, even the ASPA committee at the primary school, everybody knows how to do Indigenous education than us, the ones who've got expertise in it. Everyone else knows how to do it. I can tell you that's not true. It's not true. The Indigenous leaders need the resources of the institution to be successful, not the other way around. And you will be successful if you actually draw upon their expertise, and you have to. So what are the traits of a successful Indigenous director, if you like? And again, this is just something I've seen across the sector. The first thing you would say, if you ask an Indigenous director or a director of Indigenous education, what is 9 to 5? And they should reply, surely that's the Dolly Parton song, because I work 60 hours a week. Okay? Maybe 80 hours a week. Because we have to be better than the non-Indigenous crew. We have to be. Because that's our lot in life, sadly. We have to do it good, and we have to do it better. Because you know why? Because the spotlight's on us 24/7. It's 24/7. We have to do it better. We don't want to, we can do it just as good, but we have to do it better. Otherwise, all of a sudden, people go, oh, yeah, some issues there. It's It's important to look after your Aboriginal and Torres Islander staff. They are the biggest commodity you got in terms of your Indigenous strategy and are the critical success factor in actually ensuring that you have success in the Indigenous space. One of the troubles I had here, not just here at the Ngunnawal Centre, but also at ANU, was the public service pays a hell of a lot more money for a lot less qualifications. Public service pays good money for a bachelor's degree, and that money, the equivalent money in the university, you need a PhD for. Okay? So you've got to look after your staff. It doesn't mean pay them a lot more, it means look after them. Look after them. And we can talk about that personally if you want some hints about how to do that. One of the troubles I see across the academy, especially with university with small Indigenous staff numbers, is there's usually one or two people that's on every committee. On every committee. Ethics committee, equity committee, education, research. And don't worry, I've been there myself. And if you look at some of the Indigenous or Maori leaders, Graham Smith, for example, calls that the politics of distraction. Keep them busy so they can't get on with the job. Okay? Keep them busy. I'm not saying it's not important to be on selected committees, because that's where some of the decisions are made. But don't put your staff, Indigenous staff, on every single committee, because you won't be successful. You just won't. In fact, you'd be surprised, even the federal departments, colleagues in federal departments will ring me and say, I've got an Indigenous staff member who's not performing at the level I expect. Uh-huh. And the first thing I say, how many committees are they on? And I list five or six committees, and I said, there's your problem. Those committees are what's important, what they think is important to you for them to do, are all those committees. Take them off some of those committees and you'll be successful. And if you can't have any, if you haven't got any more Indigenous staff to put on those committees, employ more Indigenous staff so you can. It makes sense. It's not rocket science. It's important. Important. Don't let them sit on every committee. You won't have success. You just won't. I want to digress now for a little bit, because I want to now talk, if I might just move away from here, talk about my institution, about the University of Newcastle, and why I think in the Barrett Review was listed as the number one institution in Australia for Indigenous higher education, and the best practice model for the model that it has, not only nationally, but internationally. So I want to touch on this, about why is Wollotuka so successful. It might be interesting to note at this point that the Ngunnawal Centre, the Jarbul Centre and Wollotuka are all the same age. They're all 30 years old. Okay? So just remember that as I go through this. So what does success look like? What does Indigenous higher education success look like in reality? Wollotuka Institute has this huge footprint. It has three campuses across all these nations. The primary campus is on Wollotuka country, Wollotuka nation. Dargyam is a bit further south in terms of the central coast. Biripi shares the boundary with Warrawai and Wanarua. Wanarua is the water hospital. And we have a campus at Port Macquarie as well, very small. At the foundation of Wollotuka, you would have seen in books and books, some of you guys got some books, I didn't, couldn't bring a whole heap of them, but you look up cultural standards on the web at the University of Newcastle, you'll see the copy of this. The University of Newcastle has something rather unique to any institution in Australia, any Indigenous institution in Australia. It has what we call the cultural standards framework, which determines how we interact, not only internally, but how we interact with our partners, the people who want to partner with us. This is a cultural standard that we actually don't compromise on. This is how we do it. This is our business model. This is going to be the first university in Australia, mid this year to be accredited with a WIPC, with WIPC, the World Indigenous People's Indigenous Higher Education. We are going to be the first institution to be accredited this, and the reason why we can be is because we're so unique. It's because of the way we're structured. You define Wollotuka as a community. We don't see it as a centre or an institute necessarily. We've got to call them these sort of things because universities want us to call these sort of things. We see ourselves quite different from everybody else. We take, and if you look here, Wollotuka plays two significant roles within the university. Firstly, one, we share our knowledge to enable and enhance the Western environment. And the other one is to build the foundation. Now, achievements are hugely recognised, and if you look down the bottom here, it's the best practice of Indigenous higher education in Australia. And it's world's best practice as well. If we look at the numbers, we're well above parity and have been for many, many years. And this is only part of the year, this is only 6 months. So you can see the numbers are growing significantly over time. And you can see, why is this? Why is this? So we can see, I'll go through this, 951 students last year on average, but we picked about 980 or something like that. That's the average. We want to do a calculation, a few more of them than anyone. But that's going to be the official figure for 2014, 951 students. 44 hours from the start. We picked the 46 full-time class, but again, that's the average. 76 average from the start from Torres, Fox University. And that's on average. Again, we picked at 81 last year. Highest institution in terms of physical numbers, and the highest institution of staff and student numbers. Well above parity, 3% all the way along. And in fact, this year, phenomenally, we gave out 258 or something like that offers. First round offers, not second, third, fourth. Then there's first round offers. University of Newcastle does something, the most unique enrollment process I've ever seen in any university. Every average entitled on the student who puts in a first round offer will be interviewed with a community member and with an elder, and a Wollotuka staff member. And what we do, we run them through what we call a cultural affirmation program, I suppose, in many ways, is to ensure that they have a confirmation of Aboriginality. And if they don't have it, they're not going to get the scholarship, they're not going to get into the APAC program or any of the Indigenous programs at all. So we make sure that every single one of those students has a confirmation of Aboriginality, and if they can't, we will work with them to actually ensure that they do get that. If we didn't have the confirmation of Aboriginality process, we would have a whole lot more students. We just don't let anyone in. Got to have a confirmation of Aboriginality. So we can see there that we run, two degrees, I suppose, in many ways. So we run a Bachelor of Aboriginal Professional Practice and a Bachelor of Aboriginal Studies Honours out of Wollotuka. That's our program, that's what we drive. We have 33 Aboriginal trial programs that are PhD honours across the university. And we run out of Wollotuka 29 courses or units. We'll do, run that, with a total enrollment count of 1,800. So some of our courses are quite small, but some of them are very big. So some of the first year courses are very large, and some of the later courses are very small, like on mass universities. If we look at the staffing arrangement, this is where it's really exciting, I think. This is awesome. This is what makes Wollotuka so very, very special. If you're not Aboriginal, you can't work at Wollotuka, okay? That's It's not a written rule. That's what Wollotuka has done for many, many years. We can't espouse that our cultural affirmation, we have non-Indigenous staff teaching Indigenous studies. It's not going to happen. It doesn't matter. We can't have non-Indigenous staff teaching in non-Indigenous education, medicine, or health, midwifery. All Indigenous staff. Even our casuals, we had 17 casuals last year, and that's what we did this year. All Aboriginal Torres Strait Islanders. We don't have Indigenous support at all. It just doesn't happen. We run our own show, we do our own thing. And that's why, partly why, Indigenous, we are so many Indigenous students. Now, we want this. We have an unusual governance model. I'll talk about that a little bit later on. But that's sort of my role as the Dean of Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander Education and Research. My role is across the university. So I have a university-wide responsibility for all Indigenous research and education, and also, with the other hat on, a completely separate hat, and bucket of funds and everything else, I'm the Director of the Wollotuka Institute, the academic arm. I'm responsible, I have all delegation for all this, but I primarily have my management responsibilities for the academic arm of Wollotuka. We have another Director of what we call Chair of Indigenous History, that's Professor John Maynard, an eminent Professor of History. Most people probably would know that, but I don't have to do. Incredible. We've got an Indigenous doctor, Associate Professor Peter O'Mara. He takes care of the Indigenous doctors, Indigenous health, Indigenous medical streams. as well as some of these lecturers that work here, and a full-time student support officer, or what we call student engagement. Support has this connotation that it's a deficit, right? We want to move away from this deficit thinking. So we're having a thing called, we want to use the term engagement. Engagement's much more important than support. Support assumes, everyone assumes that you're not quite good enough if you need support, but engagement is the word that we use. So if you look over here, this is a significant part of Wollotuka. We have what we would call, I suppose, a council of elders. So we employ three elders and residences, and elders and residents at different campuses. We also have a council of elders that makes up 10, what we call nearby, or elders, not the elders, they're wise people. They don't want to be called elders, they've got to prove it is the Moromai word, or the Wollotuka word, nearby. And they sit and decide and ponder what we should be doing and give us some feedback. We also have a board, the Board of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Education and Training, it's called Research now, it's my new title. And wouldn't be surprised to know that I was deputy chair of that for a few years. And we had a long association with Wollotuka on that board. I carry responsibility for Indigenous employment across the university as well. We have a number of conjoint professors. Professor Bob Morgan has been in Indigenous higher education for a very long time. Associate Professor Joe Fraser, his real name is Anthony, but Joe Fraser, he's a conjoint out of Hawaii, University of Hawaii. And we just brought on Rob Tierney to help us with our international strategy. We're branching into an amazing space. Anyone done any work in China? They can't get enough of us. So we're branching into China. We're off to Mongolia a little bit later on this year, and we're branching out into an amazing research and education opportunities. China just can't get enough of us. And we've been to Beijing Normal, been to Minsu, it's just in Nankai University, just absolutely incredible work that they do. And we're branching into that space. We have a whole student engagement team. So we have a whole student engagement team on campus who do work group is for one faculty, the one group of students. They provide scholarships, and they provide support, engagement, referrals to services, and just make sure that their life's okay at university. We have so many people, it's so hard to actually remember everyone does. We have a whole community engagement team, so the whole team goes out. We have one person, who all his job is to go sit on boards. And that's all he does. Go sit on boards and say, look, this is what Wollotuka does. Can we help you? Is there something in your area that Wollotuka or the University of Newcastle can help you? Is there a conundrum that we can help you with? And then we mobilise our research teams through what we call the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Research and Innovation Cluster. And we mobilise our researchers inside Wollotuka, but external to Wollotuka as well, to actually solve an issue. And it is just amazing to be a part of all this and see this happening in real life. And then we've got a lot of administrative offices. We need a lot of support. The team is absolutely incredible. I could go on this forever. I won't. And then so the board here, our nearby here, staff and students, and that's normally where we get support from. So the four of us as directors, we report directly to Deputy Vice Chancellor, academic, and he's incredibly supportive of Wollotuka. This is, I won't go over this very much, to say that there's four directors. We're normally, sort of normally, we like our delegations for everything, so we have autonomy. It's important that we do have autonomy, otherwise it just doesn't work. We provide feedback to the university on things that they might not even think they need feedback on, if I can put it that way. So we have great autonomy. And a lot of respect.
Just sharing the space. And this, we believe that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students to achieve through a holistic approach. And we do that, we take a very holistic approach to how we do things. Wollotuka has only been around since 1983, but it has a purpose-built building in 2002, and it's an incredible one. I invite all of you, if you have an opportunity, if you're ever dropping past the University of Newcastle, please drop into Wollotuka and come and have a look. I've invited, just recently, I've been inviting all these heads of school to come and visit me in my office.
And they look out, because it's a beautiful building. It's got red dirt around the edge of it, just purpose-built. It's absolutely gorgeous. Let's see if I can get to that point. I'll photo in a minute, I'll show you in a minute. One of the other things that we do very strongly and very, very well at Newcastle is digitise the curriculum, because we have the resources to do that. We have the people and the expertise. If it's not in the university, we can go get the expertise, and we can draw on international partners to actually help us with this as well. Now, this is the Wollotuka. We have this beautiful building. I should have got another photo, but let me tell you this. This is except for the Mozzies. Anyone who's been to Newcastle knows a few Mozzies. But all the heads of school have come to see me and said, you live in an amazing space. What a beautiful place. It's a beautiful, lovely, straight out, no boundary. And the architects sort of get really excited by it. But even the engineers do. So it's a lovely place to work. It's part of the environment. It's open. Open to the natural light. It's open to natural air. And there's sort of, there's a seamless between the two parts of the institution, two parts of Wollotuka and the rest of the institution, if you like. So I want to finish up very quickly. Just touching on those critical success factors again. So in summing up, the critical success factors that I believe we need in Indigenous higher education is investment from both university and the government. If we want to maintain our success, we're going to have to invest something. Okay, we're going to have to do something about this. And if we don't have the Indigenous tutorial assistance scheme, and I'm not saying that anyone that knows me knows I'm really open to change. I just want success. I just don't think the Indigenous Investment Strategy is going to provide that. I really don't think the abolition of the ITAS program, we're going to see some troubles. Faculties can provide support in addition to the Indigenous Centre, not instead of. The Indigenous Centre should drive the strategy, and we need to work out a way how we're going to cope with the increasing number of students. Because the faculties can't cope already with our students, and we've got to work that out. Most importantly, I think, with the potential of more students, we need to invest now. We need to invest, government and universities, but I think universities are going to have to toe the line a little bit in this. And before, just to finish on some really wise words of a very respected educator, Dr. Chris Sarah, and he emphasises these words everywhere he goes. And he says, do things with us, not to us. And with that, thank you very much.